Hello folks, in this video I want to talk about this very interesting cell design for making solar cell called the HIT cell. And this was a big hit for the company which makes these cell, which is a company called Sanyo. It's a Japanese company famous for making other electronics as well. In fact, last year, this was acquired by another Japanese company, Panasonic. So I should rather call it a HIT cell by Panasonic. And this name HIT, it's not a marketing ploy by the marketing department of Sanyo or Panasonic, but it's an abbreviation for heterojunction. So this H in this HIT cell, it stands for heterojunction, and this I stands for intrinsic. And this T stands for thin layer. So this HIT cell, it stands for heterojunction with an intrinsic thin layer. And how this cell works can be understanding by understanding these three terms, that is this heterojunction and this intrinsic layer, and then the requirement on this intrinsic layer to be thin. So shown here is a cartoon which informs of the cross section of this cell. So the majority of the volume essentially is occupied by this crystalline silicon, which in this case is shown to be doped n-type. But you can see that there are no junctions located inside these crystalline silicon cell. So these junctions, these p and n dopings, are located in this amorphous silicon. And that is why this name heterojunction comes along. So it's a heterojunction between this amorphous silicon and crystalline silicon. Also, between this p-type amorphous silicon and this crystalline silicon, there's a very thin layer of intrinsic silicon. And similarly over here, between this silicon and this n-type amorphous silicon, there's this thin layer of intrinsic silicon. And that is why this I in this HIT comes from. And then it's also very thin. Another thing that you notice on this cell is that the top and the bottom are covered with this blue layer, which is a conducting oxide, in this case indium titanium oxide or ITO. And there is covering this PNN type doping. So in this video, I want to understand these three components, this heterojunction, this intrinsic layer, and this requirement on the intrinsic layer to be thin. A good advantage that you get from making this junctions inside these amorphous silicon layers is that you don't require high temperature to essentially activate the dopants or diffuse the dopants inside the solar cell. So as compared to other traditional design, this whole solar cell can be processed at a very low temperature. So this whole process flow for making this solar cells can be realized at a temperature of around 200 or 300 degrees centigrade. And that allows to make these cells on very thin silicon wafers. So these cells can be made on silicon wafers which are less than 100 micron in thickness. And as a result of that, if you make solar cells on that thin piece of silicon, they become flexible. So whenever you thin down wafers, silicon wafers to very small thicknesses, they become flexible, and then you can bend them as it's shown in this picture over here. So a key component of realizing this HIT cell is the heterojunction, which helps in realizing the selective contact. So selective contact is something that I have mentioned to you before, but let me refresh it again over here. So let's consider this band diagram for crystalline silicon. Now to realize a solar cell, what I need is essentially I need a selective contact, which collects one kind of carrier on one end. So I can I let's say I can imagine this imaginary semiconductor, which forms a heterojunction with my crystalline silicon, such that this band alignment is in such a way that this contact can essentially easily collect my holes, but it blocks the electrons from reaching this contact. So that any electron which tries to reach over here, it sees this barrier and it's essentially sent back. So it is a selective contact for collecting my holes. At the same time, I see this contact is blocking away my electrons. So I call this essentially this layer of semiconductor that I have put, I call it as the electron blocking layer, or I can abbreviate as EBL. Similarly, I can imagine another imaginary semiconductor with a band alignment with respect to crystalline silicon such as this, such that this is very conducive to collect the electrons at this end, but it repels all the holes which reach over here. So it repels and sends back all the holes which come over here. So it I can call this this particular layer as the hole blocking layer, because it's blocking all the holes while collecting all the electrons. So this is an ideal world hypothetical realization of this selective contacts using these heterojunctions, where I have offset such as this, such that one of these forms a very good electron blocking layer and a very good selective contact for holes, and the other side I have this hole blocking layer which blocks all the holes but collects my electrons. So while these would be the ideal band alignments for these hole blocking layer and this electron blocking layer over here, these kind of band alignments are not often realized with the set of semiconductors that nature gives us. So let's talk about band diagrams and this electron blocking layer and hole blocking layer for a realistic system. So let me consider the case of amorphous silicon and crystalline silicon, which is the heterojunction of interest for this solar cell. So amorphous silicon, it has a much larger band diagram as compared to silicon. So this amorphous silicon, it has a band gap of 1.7, approximately 1.7. On the other hand, crystalline silicon, it has a much lower band gap. Let me draw crystalline silicon using orange over here. So my crystalline silicon, it only has a band gap of approximately 1.1 eV. And this crystalline silicon and amorphous silicon, they find this type 1 kind of heterostructure, where this band diagram of crystalline silicon is contained within this bands of amorphous silicon. So there's a has to be a total offset between the conduction band and valence band of 1.7, which is the band gap of amorphous silicon minus the band gap of crystalline silicon 1.1. So there has to be a total band offset of 0.6 eV, which is distributed between this conduction band offset and this valence band offset. And for quite some time, it was the exact value of these offset was not known, but now there's a understanding that this value of conduction band offset is roughly 1/4 of this total offset. So this conduction band offset between amorphous silicon and crystalline silicon is approximately 0.15 eV, or 150 millielectron volt. And 3/4 of this total offset is located in the valence band. So this valence band offset is 0.45 eV, and together they combine to absorb this total offset of 0.6 eV. So I see that majority or 3/4 of this offset is located between this valence band of amorphous silicon and crystalline silicon, and 1/4 of this offset is located in the conduction band between this amorphous silicon and crystalline silicon. So two of the advantages that I get by using this wider band gap material, a heterojunction with a wider band gap material, is let's imagine if you use this heterostructure with this wider band gap facing the sun. So let's say I have this light shining from this side, and this is essentially, you know, my amorphous silicon is facing the sunlight. So what will happen in that case is that if the photon energy in this case is less than the band gap of amorphous silicon, which is higher 1.7 eV, all of that light will essentially, you know, it will get absorbed in my crystalline silicon layer, and this amorphous silicon will provide a very good window layer for this light. Also, another advantage that you get is that this amorphous silicon, it forms a very good interface. It forms a very high quality interface with this crystalline silicon. So I have this crystalline silicon atom located at the surface, and then I have this this interface with the amorphous silicon, which is also made up of these silicon atoms. So over here I get a very good quality interface. As a result of that, the surface recombination velocity, or the recombination velocity at this interface between amorphous silicon and crystalline silicon, is very low. In fact, people have measured these recombination velocity, and on any given day they often lie less than 100 centimeter per second. So you can obtain a very good passivation at this surface, and that is that in fact results in a very high open circuit voltage that people obtain with this head cell. So this head cell often gives open circuit voltage greater than 0.7 electron volt, which is reflective of the fact that you have way less recombination. The more recombination you have, especially the more surface recombination you have, lesser is your VOC. So this higher VOC is reflective of a very good surface, which is also measured by this very low surface recombination velocity. So that's another advantage that you get from using this heterojuncture.